So growing up, my parents always told me, Michael, you need to be successful and get a good job, because I didn't get to go to college. But I never really thought anything of it at the time, because all I knew is I was going skateboarding all day until I couldn't feel my legs anymore, which as a young kid and teenager, you know, with a ton of energy, was likely never. So I have two older brothers, Richie and Matt, who both played football like their whole lives throughout high school, college, and one of them also coaches it right now. I played football for a little bit, but I decided to just stick with skateboarding. I'd say it's probably the best decision in my life, just because there's nothing else I could really attribute to my resilience, both physically and mentally. But you may be thinking, how does a piece of wood with some metal and wheels attached to it make you resilient? So I just wanted to show you a quick video about what I do, and then I'll explain a bit after. Summary of like probably about 4 or 5 minutes of some of my favorite tricks, but you know what it doesn't show is the tens, hundreds, you know, if not thousands of attempts and falls, you know, I had to take to land a lot of those tricks. Like the first trick in the beginning where I like slammed in the ground, that probably took me like 3 years to land. I broke like 5 boards within 2 different days, so that's what I mean about how skateboarding has made me resilient. Like it's literally slamming into the ground, broken, you know, limbs on my body. You know, of course, harassment from the police on the streets, a bunch of broken boards. But you know, what it's really taught me is to never give up on anything in my life, because you can only, you know, try it again and again and again until you finally get what you've been working towards. And second, it's also taught me love, like a love for being active, a love for loving others, and a love that, you know, when I finally had a trick that I've been trying for so long that I can't really describe what it also would relate to. And another thing I love about the skateboarding community and culture is just that there's no language barrier. So whether I go to a skate park here in LA or, you know, Africa, Asia, China, like you can name the country or continent, it really doesn't matter, because you can kind of just connect with anyone just on the premise of you have the skateboard. And third is fearlessness. Of course, with skateboarding, you have to be fearless. You have to take risks. So you definitely, I'd say about 20% of skateboarding is physical and 80% is mental. That kind of surprises people, but the 20% of physicality comes from just learning a trick. So once you do it over and over again, it's kind of like muscle memory. So I'll know like exactly how to flick my foot or heel or turn my shoulders. So you learn like exactly how to balance on certain tricks. The other 80% of mental is kind of just being able to overcome that. So you can't think about it too long. Too hard, or else you're gonna like psych yourself out and just kick out your board because you're scared. So you have to just, sometimes I just imagine myself landing it and then kind of just rely on my muscle memory. And lastly, I've never really described myself as being creative, you know, artistic or anything, but when you think about it, skateboarding is very creative. So I wanted to see, does anyone want to answer, like, what do you see in this picture here? Okay, you see stairs, but so I'd say if I showed this to like the normal person wasn't talking about skateboarding, they'd be like, oh, okay, like that's St. Rob's or there's a palm tree. Like you see the stairs, but like what I see is, you know, this perfect ace there I could do tricks down, mm-hmm. or this white ledge here that I could possibly do a grind on. So, you know, that's the awesome thing about skateboarding. It's like the world becomes my playground. Like, yeah, I'm 20 going on 21, but I feel like the world is my playground just because everything I see, like the stairs, rail, loading dock, it just becomes like an obstacle for me to try something new on. It really made me think about, you know, what is success to me. So in high school, I had the opportunity to define what I thought success was in my yearbook. So I went home, opened it up, and I said, success to me is not having tons of money and material things, but rather having the willpower to never give up at any point in your life. And I think that's just because high school was kind of a rough time for me. You know, from having to, I feel like I had to grow up much quicker than my peers, so having to go between like my mom's, my dad's house, moving a lot, and, you know, just having to work like 20 to 30 hours a week ever since I was 16. Sometimes just sleeping at friends' houses or at school because I felt like that was the best, you know, option for me at the time. But I just tried not to let, you know, those struggles really inhibit me or, you know, be an excuse for why I can't succeed. So I did graduate from high school with a 4.1 GPA, and I got accepted in every college that I applied to. And then going on to college, if I were to define success today, I'd probably say that it's investing in yourself so that you can invest in others. So of course, you know, that's selfless, mindful, and requires you to really think about, you know, what are my passions every day. And as you can see, they're both very much related. A lot of my values have stayed the same, but they've definitely, you know, grown, branched out to form new ideas. I think investing in others, like I talked about, I've had a lot of people invest in me, and these are just three people that have really paved, you know, the path for my life. First is Aristotle Mosier, who is my formal mentor for this class. So he's my former instructor for my educational leadership course. I took the second semester of my freshman year, and he really just brought clarity to, you know, like my personal values and strengths, like doing like the strengths quest assessment most of you probably have done before, as well as, you know, what are my short-term goals, what are my long-term goals, and really just being able to see those visually was really helpful in a project that I made instead of just, you know, saying it. And two of these goals were to study abroad in Europe and to graduate from LMU in 3 years, so I've almost accomplished both of those, as I did study abroad in Madrid, Spain last semester, and I just registered for my last semester here at LMU, so super excited about that. Kind of bittersweet. And then second is Teresa Long. She's my she's my teaching mentor. So she's ironically my high school counselor as well. So if it weren't for her, I probably wouldn't even be here today, or at least at LMU. So she helped me get to college. She's helped me throughout college. And most recently, she gave me the opportunity to get some teaching and counseling experience in a classroom setting. So that's something I was really looking to see if I could see myself in this setting. And lastly is Prince E. He's my inspirational mentor. So someone I've never really met before, but I really look forward to, you know, seeing his videos because he really motivates me and inspires me to think about a lot of social issues that I'm passionate about, like education, the environment, you know, racism, and so on. And I think, you know, inspirational speaking or motivational speaking is something I'd love to do in my future. And that kind of translates into, you know, what is my philosophy of life? I think it's really all about your attitude. You know, if you want to be happy, choose to be. Like, I know that sounds crazy, but I've been trying to work on it. But it's more of like, if you wake up every day and like tell yourself, like, I'm going to have a good day today, I'm going to be happy, and try not to let like little things get in the way, you know, like someone honking at me, like, don't get so stressed out about that. It's, you can't really control it. So I think if you just have that mindset, it really works. And that's why I wear this bracelet on my right wrist every day. It says SPED, S-P-E-D. It's an acronym for Stay Positive Each Day. And a football coach from my high school gave it to me. So his name is Bert. He's a huge inspiration to me. And it's just a little reminder to, you know, stay positive. Don't let little things get in the way throughout the day. And before I answer this question myself, I'd love for you all to kind of partner up, talk to each other about how a service or international experience challenged you or changed you. And then if you haven't had experience with that, that's totally fine. Just talk about how you think taking yourself out of your comfort zone would challenge you or change you. And we'll take like 1 to 2 minutes to do that. So everyone feel good about what you talked about? Does anyone want to start with what they shared or what they heard from anyone else? Priya, I heard something you said. I thought it was kind of cool. Did you want to share?
For me, I talked about service, and it both challenged and changed me in regards to it's like you're looking in, like you're outside looking in on different perspectives, and not perspectives, on the situation, and 9 times out of 10, like sometimes you think, well, why can't they just change it? But really, there's things put in place that don't allow them to change.
Yeah.
And it's giving them the resources and that kind of thing to help them fix their situation or fix the problem overall instead of temporary band-aids.
Mm, yeah, I definitely agree with that. Maybe one more person? Anyone else want to share? Yeah.
I studied abroad my senior year of high school through the fifth quarter, and that was a really different experience for me because I was in a place that I wasn't at all familiar with, and I was around people who had like ideas about who I was that I didn't really need them with. But going to that school actually helped me out a lot with my shyness because it forced me to get out of my comfort zone and like make friends, and a lot of the people that I met there I still talk to.
That's cool. Yeah, I definitely agree with both of you. Thanks for sharing those. So for me, in high school, I worked for about 2.5 years in retail, so I definitely developed like a business mindset, and that's why I chose my major to be business management. But I definitely liked helping others, and service was something I was passionate about. So these are just some of the things I've done at LMU. So like De Colores trips to Tijuana, Mexico, where, you know, sometimes you're working with a family of 7 who may be living in, you know, like a torn up trailer half the size of our dorm rooms on campus. And what's amazing to me is just like being able to connect with the kids regardless of, you know, my broken Spanish or their struggles. I could just pick up a soccer ball and play soccer, and they're like the happiest kids in the world. Second is a service retreat to Skid Row, so downtown Los Angeles, basically like our backyard, one of the largest homeless populations in the nation. I'd been there a few times in high school to just give out some clothes that I'd get from free from a skateboarding sponsor. But the difference between that and then the retreat is just being able to like sit with others, listen to their stories and solidarity, which is important. And third, which I had mentioned previously before, is I studied abroad in Madrid. So that just really, you know, opened my mind to be more global and think about how I can contribute to global society. And lastly is I'm going to go on a IC, Ignacio Companions trip over spring break to Quito, Ecuador. So looking forward to that. I'll be working with like, you know, working at a working boys center. So kids that, you know, have to work to provide for their families, and grammar school teachers, and helping build a home. And for me, that kind of brought me from my transition from business to education currently. So this past summer, I co-taught 2 7th grade math classes with my teaching mentor, Teresa Long. And, you know, some of the kids were coming in wearing their PE clothes or clothes they'd worn the day before. And I wasn't even sure if, you know, they had breakfast that morning because it was in a low-income area school. So it was really, you know, it makes you think about stuff. And I guess you could say it's disheartening at the same time, but hopeful. And one kid I love to talk about is Devin. He's the one in the camouflage shorts standing right behind me. He's basically the same size as me, except he just finished 7th grade. So he was, you know, like typical class clown, always cracking jokes at the perfect time, you know, leading the class and throwing whips, watching him nay-nay. So, yeah, he was the class clown. And the thing is, like, I'd seen from the beginning, this kid has so much energy, but how can I get him to channel this energy into his schoolwork? Because he was pretty far behind in his math skills. And unfortunately, in a subject like math, it builds upon itself. So, you know, if you don't understand something like order of operations, it's hard to do, you know, like distributive property. So I worked with him a lot one-on-one, as well as other students in class, after class, and tried to get him, you know, back up to par. And it was just nice to get to know him, you know, as a student and a person, and just create these relationships with the students. But the thing is, you know, they face so many systemic challenges like poverty or even just having access to simple things like healthcare. And, you know, he's only one example, but the thing is, like, in America currently, there's 16 million children growing up in poverty. And of those, 1 in 3 won't graduate from high school, and only about 9% will actually go on to get a bachelor's degree by the time they're 25. So I think there's 18 people in this class, so probably like say 6 of us wouldn't graduate. Maybe 1 or 2 of us would actually go get a degree. So I think those statistics, as well as just my experience, really got me interested in applying to Teach for America, which is a postgrad job opportunity where you get to teach for 2 years in a low-income area school. And I have been working on it over summer and this fall, and I recently got accepted to teach middle school math in St. Louis, Missouri. So I'm super excited about that. Being able to like bring my passions into the classroom and help kids that really need it the most and kind of just go on with a new journey and move. So I kind of just wanted to leave off with this quote that I really want to implement in my teaching strategies, and that's that educating the mind without educating the heart is no education at all. So it's kind of like kids don't really care how much you know until they know how much you care. So I kind of like to think of myself as I'll be like a teacher of math and a teacher of life. So thank you.